Alrighty. Well, my name is Shane. I'm a local visual effects supervisor at White Unicorn Agency here in Dallas, Texas. And I'm here with Stefan at Industry Giants 2018 with a part of a bunch of short guys. And we're just going to talk a little bit about what you presented today and what your future plans are and things like that. So you actually said you gave your talk last night.
Last night, yes.
And so what was the main topic of that?
That was actually interesting because that's the first one I do that, but I was basically talking about my 30 years of kind of artistic journey, career, you know, how it started, and you know, what I've done for 35 years in the different industries, you know, and then my feedback and impressions and the whole journey in terms of, you know, what it was to work, you know, in a different type of industry, where it was film, animations, theme parks. So that was it was pretty comprehensive.
Yeah. Gotcha. Okay. Yeah. And so for people that don't know, you do a lot of like concept art or a lot of book covers, all kinds
of. Yeah.
And 30 years. I mean, that's, I'm not even 30 yet. So at least
a lot.
For a long time.
Well, I mean, that's what we talked about last night. I mean, it's like started with animation, which was the launch of my career.
Yeah.
Got into comics for a little while. Then from animation went to theme parks. Theme parks got into the film industry, then the film into the game industry.
So it just kind of snowballed.
And then game industry to book covers, and then after that it was a mix of doing everything at the same time for many years.
Wow. That's,
which is what I still do right now.
That's amazing. So are you full-time like freelance right now, or do you work for a certain studio?
Well, I did work for studios for at different times. When I started my career, I was working for an animation company, and that's where the start of things. So I became a director, you know, for many years doing that. Then I went to work for another company doing theme park designs, and then from that I decided to step back and do some freelance for a while, and then from that, when I started working in the game industry, I went back to work for companies because that's the best environments to work with teams, especially when you have an art director position. It's better to be in the trenches on a daily basis. And then once I was done with that, you know, I went back to freelance, you know, which is what I've been doing now for the last 10 years.
And do you enjoy freelance more than a studio environment, or what do you
It's
have a
different. It's very different. I really enjoy both because the studio environment is the interaction with the team, and that's really what you're there for, and that's
the
exciting
part.
Feedback
and things like
It's being around people that you like, that you work with, and you know, and coming, you know, working for a common goal. So that's something I've done very early on when I was working in animation, and then following up doing it for games was, you know, kind of natural for me. But working at home, freelance, there's also nothing like it.
You wake up in your jammies,
and you just get your coffee, and you take the time you want, you take the breaks you want whenever, and, you know, there's a relaxed aspect of that that I really enjoy.
So how do you stay on track? Do you have, like, any type of routines that you do? Like, you know you have to get up at 8 o'clock, otherwise it's ruined.
Well, yes and no. Yes and no. It depends on the project, really. I mean, it depends on what the job needs to be, and some jobs are more particular, so then they would need certain works to be delivered, daily or weekly or at specific times. So I have to time myself to make sure that I can deliver on time.
Yeah.
You know, but usually it's very kind of loose.
Gotcha.
You know, I tend to wake up pretty late in the morning, just take my time, you know, and start the day slow, do my email, you know, check what's going on in the world and clients' feedback and all that stuff, and then get to work. And once I get to work, I'm pretty much like a machine.
And
after that, what's hard is to get out of it.
That's very true.
Take a break, get some exercise, make sure you don't get stuck on your chair for, you know, too many hours. I mean, that's pretty much it.
I think that's like a creative thing where most people, like us, we wake up later, but then we stay up super late.
Yeah.
And so it kind of is just, I'm not a morning person at all.
And it's funny because I started doing that even when I was in high school.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, so speaking of that, did you go to school for animation or design or
I did a school, an art school, for 4 years when I was 15. And then from that I went into an animation school to specialize, and kind of never finished the school because I got a job at the end of the first year.
So
that started already right there, you know. It's like being late, working late, you know. The schedule at school was what it was, but there was a lot of flexibility. But I just got the habit, wanting to work late because it just felt
it came naturally. Exactly.
It's just more quiet, you got more time. I mean, it just felt right, and it kind of stuck with me all my life, you know. So I'm kind of a night owl.
Same exact way. You have to stop yourself, actually, otherwise you're like, oh man, it's like 3 in the morning, time to go to bed.
You know, it's funny because it takes time. It really takes time to get to a place where you find a routine that's healthy.
Yeah, and it works for you as well. Yeah. So time management is huge, I guess, for you as well.
And
so.
it's really a hard learning curve, really.
Yeah.
It took me years to kind of figure out, okay, you know, you can time yourself differently. You don't have to be stuck at your chair.
Oh, yeah.
And just take breaks, you know, just go play, do something, you know, go outside, walk, you know, just
experience
run,
the world, not the screen.
Do some exercise. Exactly. Yeah. And I think what's interesting is now that I live in Santa Fe, I really, really enjoy that more because I'm in the scenery.
Yeah. Yes.
I made sure that I picked an environment that would just be conducive for me to want to be outside.
Yeah.
Oh, that's just awesome. Love it there. So it's like,
Do you get a lot of your inspiration for a lot of your art from being outside and in nature? Because I know you worked on Rage, I believe, which is crazy, environments and stuff. So.
Well, Rage, I was here when I was doing it. So, you can't. Dallas is not really.
Not post-apocalyptic.
You could imagine Dallas in the post-apocalyptic, but that didn't really kind of inspire me that much. But where I am right now, yes, much more. And actually, it's kind of interesting because I just worked on Alpha.
Yeah.
That's being showcased right now. That's being then shown in the theater, and all the cloud scenery comes from Santa Fe.
Oh, that's
all the inspirations, all the things that I put into the painting was coming from
me being there every day.
They have the most incredible sunset there. It's just unbelievable.
I can't even imagine.
And so I was taking pictures every single day, and all that stuff made it into a film.
Wow.
So that was just
that's pretty awesome.
Perfect.
So that's where you got your creative vision from.
And
you're from France, I'm assuming. Yeah. So how does the scenery there compete with Santa Fe?
It's very different. France is beautiful. I mean, it's everywhere you go. I mean, it's just, but it's a different type of beauty. You don't have the sky you have in New Mexico. I mean, this is the biggest sky in the world. I mean, I've never seen anything like it. The fiery colors that you get in New Mexico is unique. And the fact that you could be looking at hundreds and hundreds of miles because you're sitting in a mesa, so it's it's infinite.
And going forever.
That you don't have that in France. But what you have in France is these gentle rolling hills in some areas, beautiful mountain sceneries. I mean, I come from Grenoble, and Grenoble is surrounded by mountains.
Oh wow!
So you have the Alps on one side, and you have a different kind of mountain range on the other. I mean, it's complete, and it's beautiful, but it's different.
Yeah.
So it's a very different settings, and it's enjoyable as well.
You could pull from different areas that you've been to.
Oh, absolutely.
Because I heard you earlier that you kind of moved around a little bit. So, is Santa Fe your favorite so far?
So far, yes. Yeah. I mean, every place I've been was because the work was kind of driving there. I was in California, so I love California, and I was at the right time because I was young and I needed to build my career, and so LA is a perfect place for it.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Lots of opportunity.
It's a big city, and yes, it's really the happening place. But then after that, I just moved to Nevada City, so we did that, then we moved to Washington State, then we went to Texas.
So literally all over,
Chicago for several years. I love Chicago as a city environment. Then now New Mexico, which is completely different. It's like desert land and it's just gorgeous.
That's super awesome.
But
so
yeah.
I'm kind of curious then, so working in LA in different areas, what project have you worked on that has fulfilled you the most creatively? Like that's when you look back, you're like, man, that was just so cool, so fun.
I don't think there is one in particular.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, because I've been working in so many different fields in the industry.
Yeah.
So if you ask me in animation, I would say, maybe animation, the best project I've ever worked on was Madeline.
Okay,
Yeah, that was my thing. That was my project. I was totally, in charge of that thing, and I wanted to do something very personal, and I was given that opportunity. So I was almost like my baby, and it was a very small team, so I ended up doing so many things on that project.
Gotcha.
That was very personal. If you talk about film, it's hard to say. There's so many different aspects of
films, games, books.
I know. Exactly. Game. Okay. Game. I would say Rage.
Yeah.
Really, because that was kind of from an artistic standpoint, that was really the top of what I was aiming for.
Yeah.
The quality of the engine that they had, and being able to know that artistically what you can produce could be even better than it's being realized. And that's very rare in game. Usually it's the other way around when you have to make a lot of compromise and sacrifice at the end.
Well, now with technology getting more and more better.
Yeah, and so they had a beautiful engine and technology, so the game was magnificent at the end. So
can you talk about a little bit what you actually worked on for that game?
Well, I was the art director for a project, so I pretty much touched everything that needed to be visually created, from all the characters, environments, and for the different levels. So I came early on, after the first art director left the project, and so I took over and then went with whatever had been, you know, started in terms of style guide and just went to town.
Gotcha. Okay.
So for about 4 years, yes.
You have a preference on character versus like level versus environment?
No, I mean, I'm more known for environment because I guess that's my signature, but really I'm very comfortable doing many things. I mean, you know, like I was talking last night, I mean, now I'm doing costume designs for film. I mean, it's something I didn't do, but I can do, and now I'm enjoying doing that.
Well, that's going to be kind of different, because if you're doing costume design to see, like, something that you do on paper, then to come physically tactile and into a movie, like, is that a different but cool feeling? Like, do you like the more of the conceptual, like, video game stuff, where you can actually explore your world that you created?
Well, it's very different, because for every part of the industry works differently. So, you know, it's always exciting when you do a concept for a film and you see it realized, whether it's realized as a special effect, you know, or whether it's realized in real things, like the part for the Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah,
they built the whole thing and it was right there.
But did you get to see that, by the way? Like, did you get
the... Yeah? Oh, I even, at the presentation last night, I have a picture of me inside the...
Oh, yeah, the selfie.
Actually, if you want a side story, that's kind of funny, because I design that part, and I do my job, and it's done. And then I go to the Comic-Con, because I have a space there.
Yeah.
And what I do at the Comic-Con at some point, I take my camera and I go take pictures.
Yeah.
You know, because I got like 4 hours, okay, that's...
Kill
some time, take pictures around, you know. So I'm walking around and I'm close to the wall, and then I'm turning around and I see these really cool stuff, like an engine piece. Mm-hmm. And I say, oh, good, because I always take references whenever I can that can help me. So I take pictures. And then I start walking around, and what I realize is I was taking pictures of a part that I designed.
That is too
of
fun.
A reference that I had already used to do it.
Like, that's great reference.
And I had no idea that they had brought the part there, the real thing, for people to see. They were doing promoting the movie at that time. So I was
Too funny.
I felt kind of weird.
It's like a full circle. It's like, full circle. Oh, that's great.
So, but, you know, it's kind of a reward, you know, when you can work on something and you can see realized like this. I mean, that's why in some ways I like working so much on theme parks.
Yeah.
Because theme parks, what you design is really going to be built, you know.
Which that is crazy, because I mean, do you design them like visually, and then obviously the engineers have to say, okay, how are we going to make this actually doable and safe? Or what's your favorite ride, I guess, that you've made, or is it the layout?
Well, the last two, really, because now the technology is changing in the theme park industry, so they're starting to integrate, you know, projection mapping into the whole experience, which is very different. And so the last two rides I worked on, the Pirates of the Caribbean, you know, for Shanghai, and the Avatar, the Navi journey. I mean, that was beautiful. I mean, the amount of quality that they put into the whole thing was just so beautiful. And seeing the concept and being able to follow the concept all the way, you know, to the completion of what it's going to be. I mean, that was really exciting.
Do they have to give you like the technical like limitations? Like, we want you to go crazy, but not too crazy. Like,
oh, yeah. So. Well, but that's the beauty of it, because there's so many phases in the process that you start with the ideas. I mean, it's very loose because we're trying to get everybody excited, you know, with some initial ideas of what they think, you know, the visual for the ride could be. But once that is set up, yes, that's what I get. I get very specific models, there's very specific space.
Yeah.
I know exactly where everything needs to be, you know, and the constraints, you know, the safety things, but all the guidelines are given to me, so I get this space to work with. And built with that, so everything is going to be exactly as is. There's no second guessing.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the last phase of the process, and that's why, you know, the concept that you see, and when you see the final product, they're so close, because I had all these requirements that I had to work with.
Well, I mean, and for people like me, and maybe you as well, like detail oriented, like you have to know very specifically what can I do and what can't I do, because otherwise I'll just go overboard on a lot of things. So
yeah, well, it's a communication process. Yeah. I mean, when you work with the art directors or the creative directors on a project, I mean, at the beginning, obviously you ask a lot of questions, but also at the beginning, they don't even necessarily know. I mean, I'm working on a ride right now for Disney, and I've been working on that for almost a year now.
Oh, wow.
And it's been evolving
every time,
constantly. Yeah. And so I keep redoing the paintings regularly, because now there's new technical aspect that were not foreseen at the beginning, or things that they have to compromise, because either it's a question of budget, or it's a question of safety, or it's a question of how the effect needs to work, and it's only going to be working this way. I mean, and they're finding out the same way as I'm changing everything, and it's part of a process.
I feel like that might happen a lot, both in like video games, movies, et cetera, because those bigger projects that are constantly kind of evolving.
In some ways, yeah, it's very similar. I mean, in movies, I mean, to give you an example, when I was doing a costume for Aquaman, mm-hmm. I was being focused on three or four specific characters at some point, and that took months.
Yeah.
Months of ideas. It's like, you know, you propose one and they thought that was going to be the one, and then 2 weeks later they come back and says, oh, we want to explore something else.
Yeah,
and
then we're going.
So that could go on and on for a long time until one day they said, this is it, that's the final. And it's that way because they're also trying to figure out how they're going to build it.
Yeah, exactly.
If it's going to become now a real prop and they try to figure out, okay, what's going to be CG, what's going to be real. And then they have to start also building that thing to make sure that it's going to be comfortable for the actors to wear that stuff. So you have a whole process that happens on the side of what you do. So they always come back to you and says, we need to make a change here.
Do they tell you that ahead of time? They're like, no, for sure, this is going to be CG, so you can do whatever you
want. Yeah, usually you know pretty much. To give you an example, I mean, these characters are mermaids.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
So obviously the fish tail
is not going to be.
Yeah. So you know it's CG, but where a CG kind of becomes real,
exactly.
That's the trick you have to figure out, and the design helps, you know, doing that.
So where do you pull inspiration from? So for like Aquaman, when you know you're going to be doing a lot of undersea, mm-hmm. you know, underwater type, you know, costumes and stuff, do you already have like a set idea? Do you go and look out sources? Like, what is your creative
process?
Well,
it's a process of communication again, too. I mean, there is the costume designers.
Yeah.
And first comes to me and it says, this is the direction of the film.
Yeah.
You know, but that is also given by the director in terms of what his sensibility and his visual kind of ideas are. So I'm already given a whole package of references that the costume designers is thinking about, wanting to explore that. And then after that, I'm just left to use all these references and my own, because I also have my own, to just come up with ideas, you know, and then it's an exchange, you know, you propose an idea, then you get feedback and you build up and, you know, it's like until they have something at the end
that they like and everyone's happy and stuff like that. So. Yeah, so I mean, obviously, it's been a real pleasure learning about all the stuff you've worked on. You've like 30 years is just mind blowing for me. So that's insane, and you've gotten a ton of awards as well. I mean, I can't even pronounce half of them, honestly. So, but it's super exciting. So, what are you working on in the future that you're really excited about, or maybe even currently? Like, is there anything big that you can talk about?
No. I mean, I'm still going to be doing what I'm doing right now, working on films, theme parks, doing book covers. You know, I always do that. I mean, it's part of what I do every day. But I've been starting to kind of think about other things I've never done before.
Yeah.
So I started exploring gallery work, abstract paintings, you know, because I'm trying to kind of find other things that could be exciting for me to explore.
Because you've done a ton. I mean, a wide gamut of film, you know, movies.
Yeah. And after a while, you think, okay, so I'm good at that. I know how to do that.
What's next?
What's next? Yeah. So I know I'll keep on doing that, you know, forever, but there's now a need to want to do something that's maybe more personal.
Yeah, okay.
You know, but
so kind of a personal breaks. Gallery that you could do.
Yeah. And I'm working on several projects right now, abstract sculptures, 3D stuff. I'm very interested in 3D printing and how to kind of transfer what I would do. Exactly, yeah.
Yeah,
so I'm very interested to explore that and try to see what happens with that. I'm very interested in learning more about ZBrush.
Oh, ZBrush is super cool. I mean, that might come super easy for you then if you have a very good, you know, tactile drawing.
Yes and no, because for ideas maybe, but ZBrush is a hard software to learn. It's not very intuitive, so it's going to be a learning curve, but you know, that's something I'd like to learn lot. So there's definitely, you know, a lot of things out there to keep on learning more. So that's a good thing.
And I'm super excited, I guess, to keep following you and seeing what you come up with. So do you have a website is there a better way to follow your work that we could?
The best way is to sign up to my newsletter.
Oh, awesome.
On my website, I have a monthly newsletters. I keep people informed about what I'm doing, what's happening. Sometimes I talk about my process on some particular paintings.
Fantastic.
On the film that's coming up, when I can release the concept. And you know, and then I also I'm a contributor to the Muddy Colors as well.
Awesome. Yeah.
So every month, the same way, I just put out articles and talk about things. You know,
with
a bunch of other artists. So.
You're about to get a new subscriber. So
yes.
Yeah. Well, so again, I'm here with Stefan at Industry Giants of 2018, part of a bunch of short guys. My name is Shane, and it's been such a pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much.
Pleasure here too.
So I can't wait to hang out with you later, hopefully. So
thank you.
But thanks, guys.
All right.
We'll be right back.
Thank you.